Lord, we bless you and we thank you for your word today. For Lord, your word teaches us how to enter into your presence and to receive from you. We ask today that the anointing of your word would be upon every ear and every heart in this room, that we might learn to use this word, O Lord God, to the best of our ability, Lord, knowing how to touch you. We bless you and we honor you. We ask this in your precious name. Amen and amen. You know, this is a story that you've probably heard me talk about it a few times, but it's a great story because it actually teaches you. Yeah, thank you, Brother Joshua. I'll use the electronic Bible. I'll use the King James Version. It's a story that really teaches you how to work with God's grace in your life. Now, I know that many of you probably have read this scripture over and over again about the daughter, you know, the ruler of the synagogue's daughter, Jairus' daughter, getting sick and dying, it says, and about this woman with the issue of blood. Now, oddly enough, if you look at the story, you find out that there are some similarities to these stories, and they're put together for a reason. First of all, the daughter of the synagogue leader, Jairus' daughter, was 12 years old, if you listen to the story carefully. How long was the woman with the issue of blood? 12 years. Look at that. And I know that I confuse everybody, but I want you to show you that you learn the word of God through something that I call symmetry, and that's called symmetry. Okay? So you start to see the symmetry in the word of God. I'm getting news reports from CNN. And so we learn from this, we look at it and we see that what God is trying to teach us through his word for our own lives. And what is he trying to show us? Let's take a quick look at the story again. I'm going to just read to you a few of the excerpts. And behold, there came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, "My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she may live." And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing the better, but grew worse. And when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment, for she said, "If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole." I'm going to stop there for a moment. You see, many times in our lives, what we are thinking is different from what we are doing. I'm going to say that again. What we are thinking in our lives is different from what we are doing. And then we wonder why God doesn't move in our lives. That's what this story teaches us. It teaches us how to approach the presence of God. When you come into a service and you come in saying, "Well, I'm coming here because it's my obligation," how much do you think you're going to get out of that service? Not much. But if you come in knowing that God is there and you're going to meet him, how much will you get out of the service? A lot more, right? And if you anticipate that service and you're ready to go to that service before the service even starts, how much are you going to get out of that service? A lot, even more. It's that anticipation and the understanding of desire that you have in your heart that prepares you to receive what God has for your life. And that's a process that takes place in our lives as you begin to grow. It doesn't happen overnight. It's a process where you begin to understand what you want out of life. If you expect things out of life, you're going to receive things out of life. But if you wake up in the morning, just as an example, and you say, "Well, it's another day. And your brain is going, I kind of like that. You think you're at, you know, the grocery store or Walmart looking around, and you're not focused on what you want out of life. What are you going to get? Not a whole lot, because your brain can't focus on lots of stuff. In fact, if you were to study the brain, you would find out that brain, ever seen those old movie theater screens, you know, that would one screen at a time, and the faster it went, the things would start to move? Well, that's how your brain works, actually. It only is able to, even in split seconds, have the ability to focus on one screen at a time. And when you realize that, that's why I know myself so well that I am a terrible multitasker. Terrible at it. As soon as I'm multitasking, and if I'm doing too much, you know what happens to me? Everything collapses like a house of cards. I need to stop for a minute and go, okay, let's concentrate on one subject at a time. And then I'm getting rushed. Even if it's psychologically I'm being rushed, I'm being pushed. And the more I get pushed psychologically, I start tripping over my own head, my own thoughts. And if it's people around me, forget it, I'm done. All of us are like that. There's not a person in this room that doesn't understand that feeling inside. So here you have Jairus' daughter who's sick. And what happens? The synagogue leader, he had come into Capernaum by ship. He had just left the tombs of this guy who was in chains, and they put those pigs in the water in the Sea of Galilee. And they come into this town, and he says, my daughter is sick. He gets on his knee and says, will you come to my house? And Jesus agrees. Immediately, the story goes, he goes to the press of the crowd, and what happens? There's a woman in the crowd who's had an issue of blood for 12 years. And that issue of blood for 12 years, you got to imagine what this woman has been going through. This was a Jewish culture. A woman with an issue of blood is considered unclean, and they need to separate themselves from everybody, kind of like quarantine. So 12 years, you can imagine that this woman felt rejected, felt unloved. This woman felt like she was separated from everybody else in the world. For 12 years, she suffered this. She even took everything she had financially to try to find a cure for it, and she was not able to get cured at all. The other thing we know about a woman with an issue of blood is that womb cannot bear children. It's an unfulfilled womb. How many of us in this room have unfulfilled spiritual wombs in our lives because we cannot find a way to touch the Savior and be healed? I'm not talking about just physically. I'm talking spiritually. He teaches us how here. Do you want to know?
Yes.
Okay. Good. Do you see what these problems do? 12 years feeling rejected caused what to happen? Desire was so strong in this woman's life that she was prepared and ready. And when Jesus is walking down the road, what happened? That desire touches the hem of his garment. And what happens? Healing takes place in her life. So the two things that you have to be able to understand in your life is how you feel. How do you feel? How has the world caved in on you to give you the feeling that you feel like this woman, rejected, unloved, and separated from everybody else in the world? And it was done through what? Religious righteousness. It was the religious law. It wasn't because you were a different color, a different race. It was because this was the teaching of that day, trying to show us the spiritual side of it. She was ritually unclean, and she could not bear. any fruit in her life. And so the word says that she said within herself, if I but touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. You remember when I said just a few minutes ago that what we do doesn't always match what we say? See, when your desire comes to a certain point in your life, and God allows you to come into that place in your life where desire becomes high, because what does desire do? When you really want something, you are focused. When there's something in your life that you really want, it begins to take your life and it points it in the right direction. And in pointing it in the right direction, it gives you the ability to hit the mark. Yesterday, I was teaching with some of the guys that were just, we were going over some of the things for learning how to do mass for a little bit. And I was showing them something in scripture, and I'll try to show it to you without putting it on the screen because I don't have it for the screen. But one of the places in scripture that you will see is you'll see something called an aleph and a tav. The aleph is the first letter of the alphabet. The Tav is the last letter of the Jewish alphabet, or the Hebrew alphabet. You know, in the Greek, it's what? The Alpha and the Omega. Doesn't the Word of God say? Jesus says to John, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. What I want to show you today is that when you have a fulfilled spiritual womb, you hit the mark in your life. And what do I mean by that? Well, the Word of God also says that Christ lives in you. That Aleph Tav, even when it describes something, it describes a plow shear. And that means that when a farmer goes out to farm, what does he do? In the old days, today they use GPS and tractors, as my brother Joshua reminded me yesterday. But they are also following a mark. And so a tav is a mark. The farmer gets on his ox, all right? He gets behind his ox. He puts the tool in the ground, right? And he keeps his eye on a mark. So the ox is the aleph and the tav is the mark. When you are going towards the goal in your life, what are you doing? You are following the mark. You are going towards a goal. And what is the farmer doing? He's the aleph, the ox. And what is he doing? He's making straight furrows in order to plant the seeds. You see, if you have no mark, which is, by the way, a tav is a cross. Oddly enough. You know that cross thing that Jesus hung on? You're following that mark. And so desire digs into the soil, and what does it do? In digging into the soil, it keeps its eye on the mark. If I only touch the hem of his garment, I will be, I might be, or maybe I'll be healed. No, I will be healed. That's a definitive, isn't it? That means it's no doubt in between that at all. She knew in her heart that if she would hit the mark, and what was the mark in her heart? The hem of his garment. How many times have you made a decision in your life that you were going to hit the mark? You've heard me say that sin is unfulfilled desire in your life. Sin is when you do what? Do not hit the mark. Do not hit the mark. And so you have to say within yourself, I'm going to hit the mark. I'm going to hit the mark in my life. And you've got to bring it in to your heart. And so what happens when this takes place? Immediately, the issue of blood dried up, the Word of God says. Immediately. And it says that immediately she felt that the issue of blood had dried up. And that word for felt is the same word in Hebrew for yada, which means to know. She knew it instinctively, intrinsically, that she was healed at that moment. She knew it. Do you know it? Now watch what happens. Jesus turns around, doesn't he? And says, "Who touched me?" And the disciples go, "Oh my goodness, he's gone crazy again. Jesus, don't you see that you're in the press of the crowd and you're asking who touched you?" And this woman is trembling, so much so that she gets down on her knees and says, "Lord, it was me." Why? Because they both knew it. There was a transference of power that transferred from Christ to her womb to fulfill in her life what God had called her to do. And what has He called every one of us to do? To be fruitful and to multiply spiritually in our lives. And so you see, if you're going to touch the hem of His garment in the press of the crowd, we're going to see in a few minutes what that crowd means in a moment. What have you done to prepare yourself with desire? Remember when Jesus was at the Last Supper? "With desire, I have wanted to share this meal with you." With desire. He was hitting the mark. How have you hit the mark? And so He turns around. That woman's trembling. And listen to what Jesus says. He doesn't say, "Oh, because you touched me, you were healed." He says, "Thy faith has made thee whole." How many times in Scripture do we see Jesus say, "Thy faith has made thee whole"? Or He saw faith in them and was able to bring healing. How many times did you see even Jesus go into a town and the word says that He couldn't do much work because why? The lack of faith. So what does faith do? Faith becomes a connector between heaven and earth. It brings God's heavenly gifts into your life. That means that you cannot psychologically figure it out. It's something that takes place because you know, because you know, because you know. And now this woman's healed. But the story is not over. As soon as He is done healing this woman, guess what comes along? The rulers of the synagogue and say, "Jesus, Jairus' daughter is dead." Dead. You might as well give up now. What did Jesus do? "Take me to her. Let's go. She's not dead. She's asleep." He gets to the house of Jairus. And there's a din, wailing. And what does Jesus do? "Get out. Get out." The only people He takes into the room is who? The parents and a couple of the disciples. The reason why He throws them all out is because you have to be so focused in your life on what the goal is that you cannot allow doubt and fear to be in the way. Move it aside. Do not be afraid to cast it out. Do not miss the mark in your life because of people, places, and things. And I want to show you something. These people, places, and things were not influences from the outside. They were influences from the inside. When you personally take personal responsibility for what is going on in your emotive heart, because most of the time in our lives, we are sitting around going, "For days sometimes, if only I had, if ever I did, maybe I should have." And so what takes place in our lives? All the doubts and the fears begin to flood into our lives, and we think that the young child that lives in our heart is dead. And I'm here to tell you that she is only asleep. asleep. And Jesus comes in to that room. She goes to the little girl and says, "Talitha, rise, get up." Gets up. The parents were totally dumbfounded. And he says, "Give her something to eat." That little girl, guess who she is? That's the real you. That's the one that has been asleep for so long. When Jesus comes into that upper room, he comes in to see the real you. And he says to you, "Daughter, arise and begin to eat." And then what happens after that happens? He says to the parents, now can you imagine this? "Don't tell anybody." Huh? Don't tell anybody? The first rule, the very first rule is what? The first rule is to know that it's already taken place. The second rule is to hide it in your heart. This is how the miracle power of God touches your life. You know what we do? "Oh, I've been praying. Yeah, yeah. I've been praying." "And I'm claiming." And what happens? The doubts and the fears rise up within you just as strong as, "Yes, sir." And then we wonder why we miss the mark in our lives. He says that you have to know. It's not a matter of what comes out of your mouth. It's what goes on inside your heart. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. What have you been thinking? Oh my gosh, what? I remember I used to say, "What are you thinking about?" That was when I was a little kid. "What were you thinking? Not good." And so we learn in our lives, if we're going to learn to live by faith, we need to become really good observers of what's going on inside of our emotional hearts. Because those emotions are what are connecting you to the earth. And the earth is one giant big desire. And guess what it wants to do? Suck you in and put a tomb on it. Use those desires to touch God and not the earth. Amen. Don't look at the world in the fact that these are the facts of life, because if Christ thought of the world as these are the facts, you would not have a Savior today. He took death and he made it a symbol of life. We take death and say it's final. He takes death and says, "The power of the resurrection will come into my life. I see the healing power of God touching my life." It's funny that the word for sin is hata. And the very last letters of hata is aleph, tav, to miss the mark. And so when you have not fulfilled your calling in your life, you have missed the mark. We think that sin is moral problems. You are a moral problem walking the earth. Even if you think you look right and got it right, you got it wrong. You are, that's part of your nature. That's why Christ came. That's why there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Why do we keep thinking that we have to pay for our sins when he already paid for them on the cross? Stop already. Well, I'm suffering in my life because of these things that I did wrong or my bloodline did wrong. Put it at the cross. Put it there and leave it there. You are free, not going to be free, not like you hear the prophet says, well, God is about to. No, God has already done it. You just need to connect to it. Put the connectors back in your life. Begin to use your emotions, your feelings, and your moods in your life to connect to God as opposed to being drawn away from him. If only I could touch the hem of his garment. It doesn't say I might be made whole. Maybe I'll be made whole. And in fact, I couldn't be whole because the people around me made it impossible. No, I will be made whole. That's the miracle of God. See, you participate in the act of creation. God looks to you for the gift of faith that he planted there, that every man, it doesn't say some men have, every man has. It's the gift of God, and he connects with that faith in you. But there's a lot of stuff out there that's going to draw you away. The story of Jairus' daughter teaches us it's okay to put him out. Only take the people with you, the ones that live inside of you that say, well, I got to see this. I'm expecting a miracle. I'm expecting God to work. There's nothing impossible for those who are in Christ Jesus. We are alive and not dead anymore. And who are we alive in? Not this world, but the Spirit, but Christ himself. We are alive in him. That's exciting. And so you see this story, it opens up our hearts and our minds to how God works in our lives. And I want to live like that. You turn on the news. Look, the news is even coming up on my iPad here. The world is coming to an end. 10 years, we're going to be in depression. The world is... No! I'm telling you to change the way you see it. See it as an opportunity to serve God in a deeper way in your life. See the world around you. When you have trouble in your life, see Christ in it. Don't allow your emotions and your feelings and your moods to get in your way. Use those to get into the presence of Almighty God. Not an easy thing to do when the world is trying to pull you down. And that world that's trying to pull you down, I hate to tell you, is not the one out here. It's the one that's being reflected in here. You have to change the way you perceive things. You have to look at it differently. Become a really good observer of what's going on inside of you. Recognize the fact that you have a gift from God that is your faith that connects to him. And faith, believe me, we've been taught in the Western world that faith is, oh, I'm going to just believe. No, faith is knowing. Faith is the feeling that I know because I know because I know. When you have that feeling and that faith is welled up inside of you and you are connected to him and then you are faithful, pistis means that you are faithful to what? That which is unseen. Believing those things that are not as if they were. Calling those things that are not as if they were in your life. Knowing that God is able, and when you remain faithful to that ideal, God can move in your life. And he can take an unfulfilled spiritual womb, and he can make it bear fruit. That's what he wants to do with our lives. Not one of us is different. That little girl who's going to grow up to become a fruit-bearing woman, Talitha, arise. Talitha, I say to you,
arise and begin to eat the things of God in your life. And may the Lord add a blessing to his word. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that it's so simple that a child can understand it. Lord, we pray today that we would learn to walk and live and move and have our being in you. That, Lord, we would learn to hit the mark in our life. That, Lord, the strength of you within us, Lord, will keep us focused, O Lord God, on the goal. Whatever it might be, that, Lord, we will become fruit-bearing Christians, that we become mature, and that, Lord, we would continue on with what you have given us. We bless you and we honor you. We ask this in your precious name. Amen and amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.